Next session is by LEAF, Lean Enterprise Agile Framework by Satisha. So may I invite Satisha, or you want to start from there?
Yeah, you don't have to invite me.
Okay. So we are waiting for Satisha.
Welcome back everyone. Let's give them one more minute. It's still 1:29. How are you feeling after lunch? Sleepy? Sleepy is always good, so you don't get any questions, right? Okay, please make sure that you put your phones in silent mode so that you don't disturb others and you don't get disturbed by others. And let me promise you that you will not learn anything new again. Most of these things you would have done, but many times for people to change, you need some complex things. Right? Simplicity does not sell. Simplicity in the form of complexity sells. So whatever I might say here, you might be already doing it in one or the other form, and there is nothing complex about it, no prescriptions. But like Victor was saying, there is something called a shuhari, right? What is shuhari? Follow the rule. Break the rule? No, I would say shoe. Shoe is when you follow the rules. So you have shoe, follow, and then ha. Here you try to understand and adapt to the rules, whatever you do. And then re is when start ignoring rules and then creating your own. So we talk about agile coaches, scrum masters. Sometimes they come in different titles, like sometimes even Six Sigma black belts, program managers, whatever may be the title. If you are responsible for facilitating the delivery, you are one of those. Scrum master is not just limited to scrum, right? So we have many forms of scrum master, like mother at home, who makes sure that she holds our family together. So scrum master is someone who should not build teams which follow scrum religiously. Rather, I would say a successful scrum master is one who has taken the team to this stage, ignoring rules. If they have taken the team to that stage, then you have been a successful scrum master. So although the reason why I'm saying this is because although you see quite a lot of stuff there, in order for people to get started, you need something. You need something to get started, some motivation. But once you get started, once you understand, imbibe, and then you adapt, you should take them to a stage where you ignore everything and then build your own. And also, in order to put together rules, if someone else sets the rules for you, would you follow? No, right? First thing that you would see is resistance. And I demonstrated it myself. And I was taking tea from this side of the building to other side of the building because I stayed there. So one guy came charging towards me and said, "You are not allowed here. This is only for our guests." I was really unhappy because someone was setting a rule saying that you cannot enter that building. The moment you set some rules, whether good or bad, people start resisting. So the best thing to help people succeed is understanding why we need to improve or why we need to change. Unless you understand the reason behind change, people won't embrace it. So with that, let's get started. Can we go on? Yes. What is the most important thing required for organizational changes? You know, if an organization is struggling and you hire someone to change it, can you just go ahead and say, "Let's follow Scrum, things will be fine"? No, right? Someone has put up note there, it said what is the negativeness of less? Believe me, the source of every problem in this world is people, not processes, right? Who builds the process? People, and they are capable of changing it. So no process, including waterfall, is not bad. Every process has one or the other way of helping it, and it's you who choose to use that process. And if it is not helping, you have all the freedom in this world to change it. And while changing it, you have to make sure that you understand what is the impact of that change. Let's say, to give you a simple example of systems thinking, and we're going to work on it right now, because I don't like speaking much. And please be nice to me, because I'm not so good with PPTs. And this is the first time doing something with PPTs. And then carry it back to your desk. You guys done? If organization change was, I mean, could be done in 20 minutes, most probably there wouldn't have been another industry called agile coaching, right? But did you get a feel for, it's not just straightforward process, and there are too many variables? Okay, anybody wants to share your thought on what changes you're going to bring in? Who wants to go first? Anybody who got real insights and want to share? Here, can you give them the mic, please? Shigrakudam, sir. Okay, so let's hear from them.
Okay. So we have identified, we have given the context for what reason we are doing this. So who are all the stakeholders who is going to impact this change actually? So from that, we have identified a portfolio manager who takes care of the budget and all the stuff, and the business unit heads who is coming under that portfolio manager, and project managers or program managers.
By the way, none of them are there as part of this organization. There is only business unit head, and then there are teams, no portfolio managers, no project managers.
Probably. So, and we have a team members there.
Okay.
So, these are the three people or the role which impacts this actually.
Okay.
So, how part? So, we have identified some three, four steps in place. One is the utilization capacity report from the teams actually.
Utilization capacity report from the teams.
From the teams, each individual teams. How much they got utilized within the sprint or within the delivery?
They were not using Scrum, but still they were feature teams, and they were, all of them were 100% utilized.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead.
And the second thing is skill set mapping.
Okay.
And third one is, what is the productivity?
What do you mean by skill set mapping?
Probably like what sort of skills which has got spread across between the teams, and from where we are getting more work kind of stuff. So just want to know that. So we want to get an idea of what composition of team members we are having inside that actually.
Okay, so understand the gap between incoming work versus what skills you have.
Yes.
Okay.
And we are getting the P&L report, I mean budgeting forecasting. So by which we'll come to know that which business unit head is over-utilized or under-utilized actually. So by which we'll, the portfolio manager can take a call that which team has to get allocated more and which team is...
They already knew it. They knew who is going to consume more, who is consuming less, who is consuming more. Only problem was they were not able to deliver all the projects, and everybody were 100% utilized. They knew who was under-utilized, They knew who was requiring more, but they were not able to allocate it.
And probably then skill assessment and the productivity.
So what changes are you proposing? You're still understanding the problem. At least did you understand that, you know, having reports and metrics is not going to help in actual delivery? Okay, because you already had all that information. A new report may not help, but yes, one thing that you're saying is identify the gap. Okay, let's see. Let's hear from anybody else who had got some insights. If you have some what part also, you can suggest. So let's go to how part, and then maybe quickly,
What we followed. Okay. So why, what is the problem actually? Many teams are working, few of them working on high priority, few of them working on less priority projects.
Okay.
So we have identified three actors here, team, business head, maybe team representative.
Okay.
So how we are planning to achieve is, you sit with business heads, team representative, business head especially. We have to identify what is high priority, which one is bringing more business or revenue, whatever.
Okay.
So shuffle the team, and by identifying the correct skill set, who is having to accomplish the task, and involve them in the project. And so second, we'll make it to another project, maybe P2, which is having, maybe by shuffling other resources.
Okay. So you're saying how part, in the how part, how they can help is by distributing the team such that only high priority projects taken care first.
Yes.
And then move on to the next priority.
Yes.
So first focus on, irrespective of your what kind of business unit you belong to.
Yes.
Focus on the high priority ones.
Yes.
Okay. So, okay.
And at the end, so analyze the competitors and understand where we stand and what needs to be improved.
Okay. So what changes are you bringing in to make this happen?
So shuffling the team, making the priority of projects.
You shuffle the team.
Yes.
So what does that mean? Are you going, so nobody has a fixed home then?
Yes.
So they will all be moving up?
Yes.
Okay, what challenges would you face? Who does the performance appraisal?
So it's
how unhappy people will be when you don't have your home. So basically, you're saying that there is team, no fixed business units.
Yes.
Based on the fixed project, I mean, the skill set that is required, you pick the people, work on them, and then they go back.
Yes.
Where do they go? Go ahead.
All we are thinking is only profit.
So right now, you're not thinking about anything.
No.
So there may be challenges.
We might be challenges. We might have challenges, but what we are only thinking is to what is our goal from 40 to 80%. So we just want to go a big bang approach, and all we're thinking is only on profit at the moment.
Okay. Well, that's a great idea. It's a great idea. But you're only thinking from the perspective of management, right? Do you think there will be different perspective in organization?
We can have analytics.
Analytics to keep track of them.
And we can see like how it progress towards and do some predictions.
Okay. See, this is a great idea from the business side. Business will certainly benefit from it. Do you think team will be okay with this? Take a look at everybody. Please raise your hand. Please raise your hand. I will repeat it. Everybody please raise your hand and then just point the finger, and then in the clockwise, just circle it. It looks clockwise, right? Then bring it down, bring it down, bring it below your nose, and then do it again. Don't change the movement. Same clockwise. How does it look to you now? Anti-clockwise, right? When management does something, development, the engineers, it always looks negative, right? And when developers do something, although they're doing the same thing, for upper management, it looks different thing. So it is essential that you get them together. And this is one of the tools that will help you in getting people together. Now you understood business aspect. Now you have to understand from team's perspective what needs to be changed, what behavior needs to be changed from them. So one of the behavior that needs to be changed is not having a fixed comfortable chair, right? So they should be willing to move around. So what needs to be done to make that happen? You need to think about it, right? If you don't think about it, management will enforce the rules and regulations like this, but team might quit and then leave. It becomes difficult. But that's a very good idea. Anybody has other ideas? Okay. You wanna? Okay. Other than, you can leave out the ones which we have discussed already.
Okay, I don't know how far it is different from whatever.
Okay, go ahead, anyway.
Okay, so now based on whatever assumptions it has been given over there.
Can you hold it close to it?
Okay. Every business unit has a fixed budget and they work out of the budget.
Correct.
Okay, and there are few BUs which are overloaded with the projects and a few are underloaded with the projects.
Correct.
Now the key stakeholders here would be the heads of BU.
Please pay attention.
Okay, the key stakeholders would be the head of the BU. Okay, and the person who is going to analyze. They are the key stakeholders. And now, first step is every BU head or any representative of a BU should know about what other BUs do.
Do. So they should be aware of it.
Meaning they should know how relatively they are matching their kind of work with what others do. How they can group, regroup up among BUs.
Okay.
And that is where we are going to take out the projects in highly loaded BUs and where they are going to distribute as projects and team as a whole.
Okay.
That is step number one. Okay, meaning that we are moving projects across BUs so that we are trying to make every BU as self-sufficient.
Okay.
They are in budget and they are not overloaded.
Okay.
Okay, that is number one. And number two, when it comes to the team as such, now we have rearranged projects as such and then take every BU as such and then look at the resource loading and then do the necessary reshuffling.
So load on.
It is not an easy step. Probably moving the projects would be easy, but shuffling and reshuffling the team will be a little difficult, but we need to do it as the next step of purpose.
But the solution that you see is you have to reshuffle people. So you cannot have a fixed team.
I can have a fixed team if all the,
skills are same.
You have told cross-functional.
Cross-functional. When you say cross-functional, yes.
Yes.
They have all the skills required to deliver for that particular business unit.
Right. So the next point here is like to move, before moving teams as such, ensure that all resources are really cross-functional, meaning across BUs.
Achha, so they are cross-domain as well. Not just technically.
They are not giving you a session or session. We can take sessions for...
Use the mic.
If they are not well capable to take the work from the different domains or different teams, so what we can do, we can give a domain-wise
coaching
or a technical coaching. Say maybe the one developer who is working with me is a Java guy, and then if I can able to teach him Python, so it will be add-on for even for him.
But that increases the cycle time of the overall development.
This is not exactly going to increase the cycle time, where I can say if you can give a 2-day training, he can work for 2 months for you. So, which is absolutely not increasing the cycle time for you. Because the 2-day effort that you are taking, see, programmatical languages or whatever might be going to come, it is not going to, syntax is different.
Yes.
It's not really going to make a big change. So a 2-day training or 2-day technical skill improvement can give a lot of boost up to the team to work more. It's not overloading. It is like their competency levels will go up and then their confidence levels will boost up. And it is one way for his personal development also. It is great.
Great.
So
yep.
In this way, you are getting work from the employees, which is good for the organization, in one way the employee is thinking, yeah, my skill set is improving, so my mark to market value is big.
Okay.
See, today I know two languages and two stuff, and then I know two domains where I can go sell myself good. So which is mark to market value of mine is big. So in this way, both organization and the employee,
individuals,
mm-hmm. both are getting benefited, and it would be a successful pattern.
Absolutely. But we should also recognize the fact that while that is great, two-day training might help you in getting the hang of technology or the domain, but there's still ramp up time, some ramp up time. Yeah. And so that means your cost of production goes up a bit.
But
sometimes even more also.
Instead of making them sit idle, this is better, right?
This is better. Okay, so you recognize the fact that cost of production goes up. But there is another thing called as cost of delay.
See, our main goal here is improving the productivity from 40 to 80.
For the organization.
For the organization, where we didn't talked about the cost here. So when the cost also applied, then it's fluffer, this model, where in this current given situation, the cost is immaterial here.
Mm-hmm.
There is only one thing that I want to improve is my productivity. For that, how much ever I want, I can invest over there. So in that case, only this will apply. If you think about cost, this is not so great.
So no, there are different types of cost. So one that I was trying to convey was cost of production. There is always cost involved, one or the other way. And if you are saying 40% to 80%, there is cost. The other one is cost of delay. See, if you don't deliver the important projects on time, you're going to lose some business, or you're going to lose customers, or you're going to pay penalty. So there is cost of delay in delivering your deliverables. So it's always a choice between cost of delay and cost of production. So which one you are willing to pay, based on that you make the changes. But you make a great point that, you know, that is most important, 40 to 80% rather than looking at maybe 2 days training or maybe some ramp up time. Okay.
So the controlling of that particular organization and enforcing few other directives will become easy now.
So Shubha is part of HCL, I'm sure HCL will benefit a lot. Thank you. Who wants to share? Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
Sure.
Other than what they suggested.
Sure. For us, we like to start with the business unit head. For making some change, making some improvement, it need to be start with the vision. The head should provide the clear vision to the members of organization, like this is our vision. So we are going to focus on the particular improvements on this period, by which we are trying to plan for the net results.
Okay.
So that will start with number one. And further,
so business unit heads should be aligned towards organization goal rather than focusing on their individual business unit goal.
Mm.
That's what you're suggesting.
Our goal is mainly for scaling delivery, right?
Mostly
the scaling delivery comes when there is a lot of demand. And secondly, for achieving this, we need to add something more, like for dev team, the additional coaching and engineering best practices, those need to be taken care. And also we can do the motivational things by providing some additional rewards.
Okay.
That will improve a lot. It will trigger a lot for the dev team. And the part of Scrum Master, they can try to collaborate more and ensure that they are trying to prioritize the items with product owners and team, and try to see there is no one is just waiting for some task.
Okay.
Engaging the people more.
Okay.
So I believe by trying these things may help us a lot here.
One is align the business unit heads towards organization goal.
Yeah, clear vision.
Other one, help teams with whatever they are required to do to achieve that goal. It could be engineering practices, or it could be trainings, additional people. Okay.
And even motivational things.
You are getting to some point.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. Thank you.
And we also have
directly with customers.
Yes, sorry.
They were already doing it. In fact, this was a fantastic organization. There was no Scrum Master, by the way, and it was not Scrum, but they were no less than Scrum. They had someone like product owner, and they were self-organizing teams. The only hierarchy that was there was business unit heads, but within business unit, there were so many teams, they were all self-organizing without any managers. It was already there. So even if you have very good self-organizing organization, scaling might be a problem, right? Let's go for one last one. Who wants to go? Okay, let's go to Jagan and gang. Maybe.
Most of the things have been already said. So I think one of the main reasons for one business unit, motivation plays an important factor. So
okay,
the organization can have a lot of HR and team related activities like once in a year or twice in a year. There are some programs which are employee friendly, which initiate the employees into knowing each other,
mm-hmm,
cross functional teams as well, which will play a huge part in their motivation aspect.
Okay.
This is one important thing I feel. And also another perspective is rather than shifting the teams as such, from non-performing team, you shift a performing guy to non-performing team. I think another factor could be the manager of that non-performing team, who could be the one person who is completely destroying that whole team. So
the constraint may be somewhere else.
Yeah.
Yep.
So he could be replaced with a very performing manager, and it could be seen how the outcome of that particular product goes.
So you're saying identify the constraint where the bottleneck is.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. We'll stop here. Thanks, everyone. So impact mapping is a great tool to look at the big picture, the whole ecosystem that needs to be changed. And we got four different points. One was understand what is the skill gap. The second was distribute the work not based on fixed business units but across the organization. And third was align the business unit goal towards the organization goal. And fourth one was make sure that you have enough to motivate people when these things happen. Let's move on. Let's go on. So what we are trying to do now is, so you have to identify what is the constraining factor for you to scale. It may not be just roles. It may not be just process. You have to identify where the bottleneck. It could be anything. It could be policies. It could be people. It could be process, etc., etc. What was the constraining factor here in this organization? What was pulling them back from scaling? Uh-huh. Budget? No, budget was already there. They had enough budget. Priorities? BU heads? Model, the policy. Policy was the constraint. Have you heard of Eliyahu Goldratt? This guy is a great guy. I mean, he is no more. He was talking about all this even before all those 12 folks came together at Snowbird and then came up with the Agile Manifesto. He was making use of lean principles and lean thinking. See, I don't see much difference between a systems thinking and lean thinking. When you talk about systems thinking, it talks about overall system and the process, and no system and process is complete without people. People make that system, and the founding principles of lean thinking is people. Unless you respect people, nothing works. Take Toyota, how are they successful? They just not go and tell the supplier that, this is what is required. Either you deliver or I'll go to some other supplier. They did not say that. They worked with supplier to understand their limitations and help them overcome those limitations so that you as an organization can succeed. So there was a collaboration between supplier, Toyota, and then customer. So that means respect is, when you say respect for people, it is not just respect for development team. So there are multiple people. There are buyers, there are users, there are developers, and there are sponsors who invest right in the product. You have to respect all of them. So you have to consider perspective of all of them, and then it should benefit. So what we were trying to do as part of scaling is move from fighting for budget, so there was a policy constraint, and have a winning team. And you provided some insights. Can you move on to this? Can you move on to the next slide? So anyway, it's talking about theory of constraints. These are the five focusing steps of theory of constraints, and actually you came up with these points. You did say that. Someone said first understand what is the constraint, and you said in the form of identifying the skill gap and the policy. Policy was a constraint. So understand the constraint and then exploit the constraint. That means you should make sure that it is clearly visible to everyone what the constraint is, so that you can take care of it. So all these processes that we talk about, right? Scrum, Kanban, XP, they don't help you succeed. They only help you in bringing the problem to the surface. So unless we people and organization act on those bottlenecks, nothing changes. So you can blame the process, but it is not the problem of process. It's always, as I said, source of every problem is people, and source of every success is people as well. So once you understand the constraint and then it is visible, then the whole organization or whole process, end-to-end process, should be subordinated towards helping this constraint. What you guys said, you said, okay, policy is the constraint and the skill gap is the constraint. Now let us have all these BU heads come together and then work towards increasing from 40% to 80%, increasing the project delivery. Said everybody should be aligned. That is what you are saying. And this process, the tool that you are using, impact mapping, helps you in understanding that whole ecosystem which needs to be subordinated towards the goal. And then once you have that, someone said, help them with engineering practices, help them with training, and then come bring up everything that is required to motivate people. So what are you trying to do? You're trying to elevate the constraint. So you're trying to provide every possible help to make sure that this constraint is taken care. Once that is done, then you see review what is the status. Is constraint still the constraint? Whatever we made, that did it make any impact? Did it move somewhere else? And if it is moved somewhere else, because see, just by taking one bottleneck doesn't mean that you don't bump into other bottlenecks. You might bump into other bottlenecks. Now, unless you work on it, you'll not be able to sustain. So when you talk about agility, does agility mean delivering faster? Delivering quickly? Delivering at a sustainable pace. And when you say sustainable pace, many times we make a mistake that the development team should be comfortable in delivering at that rate. No. The rate at which, yes, development team is comfortable delivering, customers are comfortable consuming, your investors are comfortable getting whatever they are expecting, right? So it should be sustainable for everyone. Just because development team wants to have fun, you cannot bring down the business, its whole ecosystem. So understand where the constraint has moved, and then again you go through this. So that is what theory of constraint says. And so in this organization, we identified policy as a constraint. And did we woke up and then said, okay, let's use this process, or did we go through the process of doing whatever you are trying to do? What do you think we did? We applied Scrum, XP, all of a sudden. If someone hires you as Agile coach, what do you do? First thing, and by the way, if someone hires you as Agile coach, Scrum Master, Black Belt, whatever may be the title, they have problem. They are inviting you to their shit so that you can clean it, right? You are you will lose sleep. So how do you clean it? Apply Scrum, apply XP, it wouldn't help. You have to understand these constraints. Yes, you have to take a systems thinking approach for solving problem, be it scaling problem or any other problem. So we about eight people, we came together and then we worked with every business unit to understand. Yes, we started with theory of constraints, we started with only two things: cost of delay versus cost of production. Because at the end of the day, organization succeeds both when you are delivering effectively, at the same time efficiently. Your effectiveness is determined by, are you delivering the right set of priorities, right set of work, and efficiency is, are you delivering at the rate at which you can make money, right? So here both effectiveness, I mean they were trying to be efficient by assigning work to every business unit as per their skills, but effectiveness was getting affected. And as a result, business units were not happy. I mean, business folks were not happy. Customers were not happy. But everybody were occupied and they were delivering something, one or the other thing. So we did work with business unit heads to understand the constraints. Yes, we applied the similar approach of impact mapping. And we created a process around theory of constraints. And we said the authors are the people who gave ideas. When do you find resistance from people for change? When it is coming down from somewhere. When do you see them promoting? When it is their process, when it is your idea, right? So yes, we did come up with some ideas and then we took to the team and said, these are some of the ideas that might help us looking at the problems that we are facing. And they gave lots of ideas, and using those ideas we created this process. Let's see what is that process. Can we go to the next one? This I call as Lean Enterprise Agile Framework. What is the meaning of framework? It solves all the problem, and you just use it and it solves all the problem. Can maybe get started, maybe it will help you get started, it will get you to shoe stage, but at the end of the day you have to reach the re stage. So this is what we got. So three things that are very much important: it's you use Scrum, use Lean, less lead.
Is everybody back? I can see that some people might have left because there is nobody outside. So can we start? So let us finish off with the infrastructure and then we'll start.
Okay, welcome back everyone. So we were discussing about the upper half of the leaf. We discussed about story mapping. So we are discussing about story mapping is required for identifying different milestones for the set of products that came out of product pipeline. And the next one is story bootstrapping. And story bootstrapping, so you identified the MVP, but in order to work together when they are from different organizations, I mean different products and different teams, there will be dependencies. You have to work out those dependencies. That becomes a challenge. Like someone was asking a question in the morning when we were talking about less, how do you take care of dependencies? So this is one of the ceremony that is done at certain frequencies. So it is cadence, not on the need basis, where business folks and technical folks come together to identify what dependencies do they have on other products in the product pipeline, and then accordingly reprioritize their product backlog. Pretty much like a brainstorming. Some product owner comes and presents, okay, this is what is we're going to work on in the upcoming sprints, or this is what is part of this upcoming release. and others, if there's notice that something that they need for them to be successful is prioritized downwards, they can convince the other product owner to move it upwards, so that functional priorities or dependencies are taken care through prioritization. So the output of this particular ceremony is also a product backlog, wherein it is prioritized based on the functional dependencies. So this was on at certain cadence. So we used to do once in 2 weeks, because you cannot once for all figure out all the dependencies. As you start working, you might find many dependencies. So it was happening once in 2 weeks. And can you go on to the next one, please? The next one is story tampering. See, if you are pulling all the people together for a meeting, and then identify all the dependencies, add the details as well, that might become overwhelming. And it will be challenging as well. When you have so many people in the room, it will not be that productive. If you have 20 people versus 70 people, of course the productivity or the effectiveness varies based on the number of people. So the story bootstrapping was just to identify the dependencies, so that in the next ceremony, pull the people whom you are dependent on and then work on the details. It's pretty much both of them are similar steps. The first one is only identification, and the second one is adding details. But only the people who are needed would come into this. Otherwise, you are not required. While the ceremony was at set frequency, the number of people that come in and who comes in, it was dependent on the need. So output of this was again prioritized product backlog with details, dependencies taken care. Can you move on to the next one, please? Anna. And this was again on need basis. This was not based on frequency. It varies based on organization, right? Some organization may not want to come up with a release plan. They might start working on valuable features, and then whenever they feel that these features add value to the customers, you might go ahead and release. So you might have a time-based release or feature-based release. So if it is feature-based release, you can release only when all the features are developed, irrespective of the time. Although I don't believe in release regime, I also understand, based on my experience, people focus more when you have targets. It helps you focus. So we used to do this on a need basis. Initially you come together based on the dependencies, and by aligning your sprints with other teams, you would come up with a release date. It's only a target date, and then that gets revised as there is a need. If there's too much of deviation for the overall release of the product pipeline. If it is about your product, you don't have to come together. You can do it among your teams. But if it is aligned with other products in the product pipeline, come together often on need basis to align as needed. And output was delivery plan, not just the dates, but what features and what outcomes and how do we measure. Those metrics would also come into picture here. Okay, so now we go back to the other side of the leaf. So story mapping helped you. So we are talking about two things: continuous collaborative discovery, and the other one is collaborative improvement, and there is collaborative delivery. So in the collaborative discovery, that's more of a business collaboration, more from the product's perspective. So story mapping helped you identify the MVP. Story bootstrapping help you identify the dependencies. Story tampering help you add details and then take care of dependencies. And release planning help you align your goals and then come up with milestones. So that is from the business perspective. And as far as product delivery is concerned, I will not get into details there. So each and every product backlog might have one scrum team or no scrum team, just feature team. Here we did not have any scrum team, it was basically feature team. No scrum master, someone called as not really product owner, they were called some business person. That's why I've been using business folks and technical folks. So you can continue to use whatever titles that you are using. Maybe You might call someone as product manager, product owner, or project manager. On the other side, you have technical teams, mostly the cross-functional team. That is very much essential. So you can pretty much use anything similar to Scrum or Kanban for the delivery at certain cadence or based on the WIP limits. But what challenges would you face? Would you face any challenges when you have teams like this? Difference of opinion. Those are people issues. People issues will be there even if you are part of the same team. What about skills? You are coming from totally different teams and you may not be able to have all kind of skills. You may not be at the same effectiveness or efficiency like you were before. It might come down. Sometimes because you have come together for the first time, you might get stuck at some point of time. So when there are impediments, what do you do? Create an impediment backlog, track them. What is an impediment? Anything that blocks your progress, that those people cannot take care of themselves. It could be something like, okay, we are working on Adobe Flex. We had not worked on this before. I had something similar. I had knowledge of something similar, but I'm not able to figure that out in Adobe Flex and I'm struggling. So as a team, you're struggling. And if it is high priority project, if let's say this team has skills, but this team does not have skills and they can help, but this is high priority project, maybe they are assigned to this project because they have domain expertise and which is more important than your technical expertise maybe. So they are assigned this high priority project to them. And although they have technical expertise and based on their domain expertise, they are given another project. If this is high priority and this is low priority, if they are struggling, even if they are busy, should they come and help them? Because for business, that is more valuable than this project. In order to make sure that that part of elevation, I mean subordination, in the theory of constraint, third one was subordination, aligning everyone towards the most important thing. So this action workout used to happen as and when needed. So if this team is struggling, they can announce to all the teams saying, this is the kind of problem that we are struggling with and this is the time at which we are going to meet. There is no end time given, only start time. You get, so the picture indicates you get into the room and you come out of the room only when you have sought. That might sometimes hamper this team's progress as well, but for business, this was important, so you have taken care of it. So that's why it is called as action workout, not just daily scrum or scrum of scrum. And it is only when you are stuck. Come together, solve the problem like war room, and then go out only when problem is solved. So that's the idea. We'll come back to that. So that is action workout to take care of impediments. The next one, please. The other problem was, like I was saying, this can be used for sometimes in the product pipeline. There are initiatives that cuts across business systems. That means you might make some design decision that might impact the other system a lot and it might break that system. So how do you take care of such systems? How do you do that today? Okay, talk, Guru was asking what is scrum of scrum. What is scrum of scrum? What is daily scrum? What is daily scrum? So development team coming together to know what is the progress that they have made with respect to sprint goal and also see if there are any impediments that are stopping them from making progress. When you talk about scrum of scrum, that is between two or three or maybe different multiple teams which are related, to talk about technical dependencies and integrations. Meeting is not important. Daily scrum or scrum of scrums are only meetings. What is important is taking care of those dependencies and integrations. And scrum of scrum is one way of handling it, but that is not the best way. there could be, there are multiple ways of doing it. Where continuous integration is much better way of taking care of integrations than Scrum of Scrum, because in Scrum of Scrum you just come and talk about it. But a Scrum of Scrum is like a follow-up meeting, so you have some dependencies on other teams, so you work on follow-ups. Whereas this is not a follow-up, this is initiating. So this is the team which is going to make some decisions, and they think that this might impact other teams. So they will say, okay, this was happening once in a month, and then later it increased to once a week, once in 2 weeks as well. You are supposed to come and then talk about what design decisions are you going to take. Not in detail, what design decisions are you going to take, and representative from other teams, technical folks, come together, and then they review what decisions you are going to take and how they will be impacted. And if they are impacted, then they will work with you to revisit your design decisions. So idea is to understand if at all any other team is going to make a decision that is going to impact you, and then help them revisit those design decisions. That was the idea of this. So that is one step. You have made some design decisions. It's only a decision. You have not implemented it yet. Unless you implement, you don't know whether it is good design or bad design. And in the process of implementing it, the solution, providing the solution, you might change the design as well. So before you roll it out, you again come back to design workshops to present, okay, this is the solution that we have come up with, and this is going to be implemented. So both ways. One is initial design decisions, and then once you have the solution, you also come and present the solution just to make sure that everybody understands the impact. So this is for taking care of technical dependencies like story bootstrapping. Story bootstrapping was for functional dependencies, and this is for technical dependencies among the teams in product pipeline. Can you move on to the next one? Now you are working together, you are not alone now, it's the whole system. Do you think there will be problems in terms of collaboration? Do you think process evolve? Or can we live with fixed systems? It has to evolve, and it has to be empirical. You have to learn from experience. So initially when we started, we did not have continuous integration. So our initial constraint was what? Policy, right? And in order to take care of that, we changed the way teams were working. But later another constraint got elevated, that was the technical capabilities. Yes, you might distribute it, but teams will not be as technically capable like they were together before, and teams were struggling to deliver. So another constraint was the integration part. We used to build something and then later you fail. So that is when we came up with continuous integration. Not just Scrum of Scrum is not going to help, you need to take care of continuous integration as well. And that was result of regular Kaizen events. Kaizen means what? It's a Japanese word which indicates
continuous
improvement, not just improvement, continuous improvement. So come maybe, this again cadence that is defined by everyone. I have put cadence and need basis, right? Need basis is understood. Whenever there is a need, you call them. Where do you define at what cadence you meet? Cadence means frequency. Where do you define that? Do you remember accelerated discovery? The whole purpose of that was to come up with collaborative agreement. So that is where you define at what cadence you meet for looking at your process, looking at your design. So at defined cadence, you come together to understand how you are taking care of your dependencies, integrations, how you are collaborating. And if someone is really suffering from lack of some skills, maybe you need to move someone from some other team there. So those kind of decisions will be made here. Continuous improvement needs, and coming up with action items. This is like retrospective for the overall product backline. And you may not be able to bring everyone together, but the representatives. So that is retrospective for the whole product backline. That is Kaizen events. Can we move on to the next one? So this is how it looks. So the bottom half of the leaf is collaborative continuous improvement, where teams are working on process improvements. And upper part of the leaf is taking care of business dependencies. And in between, what you see is either Kanban or Scrum or XP, whatever process helps you in delivery. And if you notice, there is something called as product backlog refinement, Scrum of Scrum and continuous integration. Design workshop was on, and although it was at Cadence, it was at a very high level to say that these are the dependencies. And product backlog refinement is even before you go to design workshops, and how do you know that it is going to, this is something that you have to go and present. See, you cannot have everyone come and present all the time. That is too much time consuming. Your production cost goes up. So you need to know when you are going to, when you need to go to design workshop and when not to. And those kind of decisions were as part of product backlog refinement. So if team which is going to work on some products, they can involve people from the downstream products, upstream products, or anybody who can help them in understanding the requirements. That is the main purpose of product backlog refinement, right? Understanding the requirements before you start the development. Keep it ready as per definition of ready. So you involve representative from other teams in your backlog refinement. It is very specific for your product backlog. And there, if you identify that there is some dependency on other teams, that is what you take to design workshop. So initiation or identification of what needs to go to design workshop was done in product backlog refinement. And this is collaboration. And then follow up of that is done through either Scrum of Scrum or continuous integration. And when you say continuous integration, it is not happening at the end of the sprint. Your definition of done includes, suppose if you are dependent on other team, your definition of done of a particular feature or story includes that you should have tested the integration with them and you should integrate with whatever they have. And of course, that was not there, as I said, initially. We did struggle, although we were working well as individual teams, we did struggle on integrations. And in the next cycle of accelerated discovery, we added continuous integration because that was helpful. So almost, it took 1 year for us to realize that we need to elevate the constraint of the technology or the dependencies through continuous integration. So it evolved over a period of time like this. To summarize, so this is what is Leaf. To summarize, in order for Leaf to work, you need to take systems thinking approach to solve problem. That means don't introduce any changes immediately, don't change roles, don't remove people, don't add titles, don't add people, yeah, don't do that yet. First understand what is the constraint that needs to be solved, and then you certainly need to have engineering practices in place. XP is must, of course, if it is software development. I'm talking because most of us are from software development, I'm talking about it. And then yes, have respect for people, so maybe creating something like community of practice will help. And then start every cycle of product development. It could be, you know, in some organization it could be 1 year, in some organization it could be 6 months. So when we started with 1 year, later after couple of years it got reduced to 6 months. So based on how it is helping you, you might change it. So it starts with visioning, envisioning for that particular cycle, then work with stakeholders, all the stakeholders, business people, to understand the organization goal and come up with product pipeline, and then accelerated discovery to understand what process, what practices that will help us in collaborating, which will result in collaborative agreements. And then you have three cycles going on, not just one. One is about discovery cycle, and other one is delivery cycle. In the delivery, you might, for every product backlog, you might have one team or multiple teams. No, I'm not shown that because it's kind of implicit. It could be Scrum or Kanban, but it is development. So it is continuously happening, supported by continuous integration and refinement sessions. And then another cycle is the improvement cycle, which happens some on cadence, some on need basis. It's pretty much like, you know, water flows into a leaf, and then leaf lets drop by drop the increments. That's the idea behind this. Any questions? Too much of talking already. So maybe take about 5 minutes to reflect on what we discussed, and then we can go through question and answer session. Take about 5 minutes. Your 5 minutes starts now. After this, Sabre is going to share their experience of scaling. So don't go away. You guys ready? You have 48 seconds. Everyone, Kishore has a question.
What I have observed is in this model, where does the senior management come into picture? Because generally, any things only things will be successful if we have
everyone in
the buy-in of management. This is the first question I have. And in second question, in one of the slides you mentioned stakeholders will be involved in getting the requirements. I got confused by that word. They can be a positive stakeholder, they can be a negative stakeholder. So what actually you meant by stakeholders?
So here in this case, the stakeholders for this process, for projects to be successful, I was not talking about end users or customers. These were the people like business unit heads. So both the questions, answering both the questions. So where did you involve the management? Twofold. Even before this was implemented, as I mentioned, the budgeting cycle was starting from September and it used to get rolled out in January. And we started 3 months prior to September to understand what changes need to be brought in the next financial year. And we came up with some ideas, and then we went to every business unit. We traveled to Brazil, India, US, sat with them to explain what we are thinking and get their ideas. And then this process was built with their consent. So they gave their ideas, we added some. So they were credited as the creators of this process. So before even implementing this process, their buy-in was sought. And as far as the process here itself is concerned, so these two are the places where they are getting involved. If at all something needs to be changed for the next financial year or next cycle, then that change will happen here for the process, from the process point of view. And this one is from the business point of view. So how are we going to pick up projects from overall backlog that is there, the pipeline that is there. So these two are the places where the management is getting involved. And of course, when you look at that, the upper layer, that is all about business.
So this process can be utilized for any kind of projects, like we have different types of contracts available.
So I have seen it used for initiatives which cuts across business cycle, sorry, business systems, products and process, projects. And contracting is, you know, irrespective of what kind of contract, you know, delivery matters. So you can use it for any kind of contracting. And how you manage the delivery, that is what differs when you talk about contracting.
Thank you.
Who has other questions? That's good. I can. Okay.
Satisha,
yes,
from your experience, like, you know, so far, you have introduced probably safe, or you might have introduced the less leaf and so many frameworks, you know, other than this one. So have you found a difference in, you know, people who have implemented, like, let's say less or leaf in specific organization has succeeded in a much better way than the other framework? Or have you found, like, you know, people who adopted better things from a different framework and then implemented in their organization, you know, succeeded in better way? So in a nutshell, like, you know, have you found any difference in terms of picking up one framework that helped in most of the organization, or, like, you know, customizing would help in most of the organization?
Based on my experience, even taking this organization itself, this organization had a habit of making a decision, and then one fine day, the plug is pulled, and you are on the new tool, new process, new initiative. And we did find that most of the times people were resistant, either they would leave because they are totally unhappy because you brought totally different technology or different method or different process. So in the same organization, we noticed that taking adaptive or evolutionary approach was more useful than a revolutionary approach where you go ahead and say these are the things that you need to follow from tomorrow. And looking at other organizations where I have worked, evolutionary approaches have been comparatively successful than revolutionary approaches. Which means just management cannot take decision and then say let's go ahead and implement. So it's collaborative approach. So you have to involve both the engineering aspect of it as well as management aspect of it. You cannot ignore either of them. So ideas should come from both the sides. So that's why I keep on stressing systems thinking approach. Because if you just take one framework and implement it, something that worked for Sabre may not work for British Telecom. Although maybe they are in the same domain maybe, or maybe Amadeus, although they are in the same domain, something that worked for Sabre may not work for Amadeus. Because they are two different organizations, they have different cultures, different sets of people. So taking evolutionary approach, I have seen in my experience, helps lot better than revolutionary approaches. I mean, taking example of Kanban and Scrum, you see when you go and try to implement Scrum, you'll see lots of resistance. But if you take the approach of Kanban, you might see very less resistance. But you will induce the same amount of pain either way. Whereas Scrum will be immediate pain, the Kanban will be pain gradually. So it depends on which one you want to bear. And mostly I've seen in my experience, the gradual pain is what people would prefer than immediate pain, especially in organizations. Any other question? Yes, Raj. Another one. Yes, sir. Can you help?
I have a question from this desk. we discuss on this leaf, like, we have to go on story mapping, bootstrapping, and pampering, and other three actions on the below leaf, right? And how do you define the release planning here? We doing the release planning ahead and doing this upper leaf and lower leaf first, or the second?
They are not connected. They are two different aspects. That's the business aspect. So irrespective of whether you have done release planning or not, this is required. Because you are going to collaborate. See, the difference between release planning and story mapping is, in the story mapping, you are identifying the deliverables, which anyway, you also have milestones in terms of features maybe. When you talk about release planning, it is not necessary that you need to have release planning. So I think I had indicated it is need based. In some organization, you might have to come up with a date. In some organization, you may not need the date. So when you need the date, you need to align all the business functions to the date that you want to release. So that is when you use release planning. So irrespective of that, whether you have a release date or not, this happens because anyway, work is going to happen without release date also.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? By the way, if any of you want to try it out, I can absolutely help you. I will not charge you. On a pro bono basis, as long as you are willing to share how it works with your with this community, PlayScrum community, so you can always reach out to me anytime. You want to implement, okay? So anybody wants to implement, you can always get in touch with me. You know my contact information. Can you go to the next page, please? Anna. next page. So you can get in touch with me on any of those Twitter handles or the email ID, and you know I'll be available at Lemon Tree once in three weeks. Sorry.
There is a question on bringing the team into the context of the Scrum ceremonies. So in some of the Scrum ceremonies, there are some influencers, either maybe an architect or somebody tries to post their thought process at the beginning, and then the team follows whatever they propose, because of either they are not willing to revise the statement whatever the person is telling because of the position he is holding, or they are little bit lenient on that particular thing. So is there any specific approach, or we can make the team to boot faster than any other person, so that it will be the right set of inputs coming to the Scrum?
Scrum do not prescribe anything on those lines. Scrum is only framework which helps you in having some protocol for delivery, collaborating, but it does not talk about specifics on how you influence people. How you influence people, you need to learn those techniques irrespective of what method you use. But in this framework that we were talking about, this was managed by not having any specific titles. We did not have tester, QA, tech architect, everybody were called with same title. It was a flat organization.
Okay.
But if you want specifics on how to have trust building done, we have Alok Upadhyay sitting at the back of the room. You can certainly go and meet him. He can help you with some tools and techniques for trust building, irrespective of what method you use. He is available in the coaches clinic.
Okay, thanks.
Yes. All my favorite CTS folks are asking questions. That's great. By the way, CTS is the biggest contributor for the PlayScrum community in terms of knowledge.
Okay. As an Agile coach, actually, so for the experience, what I had is it is going to be a kind of revolutionary approach.
So revolutionary approach.
Yes. So in that maturity state, Shuhari model. So since it's a revolutionary approach, so it takes time to get to one mature state, like from knowing Agile to being Agile, and to, I mean, irrespective of Agile, at least for the maturity level I'm talking about.
Are you talking about revolutionary or evolutionary?
Revolutionary.
Revolutionary.
Okay. So it takes its own time based on team's maturity and commitment and insight to adapt how they were doing it actually. So since you talk about the system thinking in place and it's an evolutionary approach, so you mean to say that from the day one, team starts with adapt maturity?
No, they don't.
Okay.
The reason why you come together to define a process of your own.
Okay.
You still start with some follow.
Okay.
But instead of taking already defined approach outside, like less, leave or safe, you create your own process as part of accelerated discovery. You come together to agree on certain process and agreements.
Okay.
And then you follow that.
Okay.
And then you adapt to those processes and then you try to improve that. That is what happened here as well.
So till that state, how long it has taken for you, I mean, to get that?
So we took 6 months to figure out this framework.
Okay.
So that, you know, we don't influence them with framework from outside world. Rather, see, I mean, as you understand, the only people who can bring about change is the people who live in that environment, because they understand the pain points very well. And yes, like you said, it is absolutely difficult to get someone started from ha.
Yeah.
They have to go through shu.
Okay.
So that's why that accelerated discovery is there.
Okay.
Where you define a process where you start following.
Yeah.
And then throw your the bottom part of the leaf, you continue to evolve the process.
Okay. And that too depends upon the maturity of the team. It may take 6 months or it may take 1 year also to get onto that actually.
I don't know about maturity. Maturity in terms of what?
Getting a buy-in from the team. Because we are bringing both management, upper management and the lower management together for this kind of collaborative exercise actually. To get a buy-in, maybe probably to get to start with, yes, we can have plans in place. To get it function in place, actually, how long it will take. That is where I'm trying to get it, actually, as a coach, because for me, actually, for different experience, like certain team comes to Shuhari, the complete state of maturity in 1 year itself, but some team takes even after 2 years also, they were not in that mature state, actually.
So that may not be maturity of the people at the end of the day. I mean, as I see, it may be the way your system is bringing the problem to surface.
Okay.
See, if you are expected, now how many of you believe that do agile is the right statement? Is that right? Do agile? Okay. Follow agile? Follow agile. Practice agile? Be agile? Guess what? None of them are correct statement. You know, why should you hire someone because they have certain skills and then bring them to organization and say, be agile? So why do you want me to be agile? You hired me because I am GWT developer and I can only do GWT stuff. What is be agile? Rather tell them you have to deliver. Does it make sense, or are you telling them be agile makes sense? What makes sense? Deliver, right? So if you can drop the jargons as an agile coach, first thing that you have to do is drop the jargon. And then focus on getting to that goal. If why part is understood, what is the vision, then there are multiple ways to align that. And in the process of working towards that, anyway, at least you are focusing on the goal. In the process, of course, you make mistakes. And then making use of those instances to influence the change will help than having a revolutionary approach.
Okay. So to get people to understand, yes, we are maturing the process and the delivery. So what are the things which have showcased to the team, actually?
It's again the delivery. How soon are you able to deliver?
Okay.
And how happy your CIO is. So metrics around deliverables will help rather than having the defect counts or velocity trend chart. They may not help you. They will only help you in identifying there is some problem somewhere and we have to fix it. But what makes sense for the business is the delivery rate.
Okay.
So looking at what we did last year, so we delivered only out of 10 high priority projects, we delivered only 4. But by bringing this change, we delivered, let's say, 6. That's a bigger improvement.
Okay.
Right? Almost 50% improvement. So we actually were making use of such stats.
Okay. To make use of this framework in place, do you have any kind of free assessment to start with? Okay.
Your team has to do that assessment.
Okay.
See, you can apply at any stage.
Okay.
You might be at restage already.
Okay.
Still you can use this because you have to define your process from scratch.
Okay.
You might be at shoe stage. See, because the team defines what process, the way you define process might change, but still this process steps will remain.
Okay.
So you might ignore some of them.
Okay.
But initially you have to define the process.
But this is totally against, actually. I mean, I'm not saying this is totally against component team, but the intent is to be a feature-based team.
Intent is to have cross-functional team which are useful for delivering value.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Any other questions? Should we give Saber a chance? Okay, let's give them a chance. I will be around. You can ask me questions anytime. So let's invite Saber to share their story, and please get in touch with me any point of time when you have questions. Thanks everyone for tolerating me for 3 hours maybe. Thank you.